Hello, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about Russian cyber threats in the pandemic era, how actually Russia seized upon the global COVID-19 pandemic as an opportunity to launch its multifaceted, multidirectional information warfare strategy against its prospective enemies, how they used their APT groups, criminal groups, to attack healthcare organizations, research institutes, and hospitals in the United States and in European countries. So before I talk about the hacking and actual disruption, I would like to give you a kind of an overview how Russia sees information warfare strategy, which kind of agencies are in charge, and what is their doctrine of information warfare, and how actually they're using APT groups and criminal syndicates to achieve their mission. Let me just give you a kind of an overview how Russian information warfare doctrine works. It is kind of an integrated system of system that works together. Everything is one under one umbrella, whether it is an intelligence, counterintelligence, masking something, attacking computer networks and software application. So now, kind of a few years ago, 2018, artificial intelligence elements was added to its information warfare doctrine. It actually contains two elements, using artificial intelligence technology in military field and in non-military field. For example, using AI technology to advance their military capabilities and using AI technology to advance their capability in the medical field, biotechnology field, manufacturing, and energy field. So they actually see artificial intelligence as an emerging tool to secure their strategic interests inside the country and outside the country. Some historical background, how actually information warfare doctrine was formed. I'm going to give you a short overview. The doctrinal and strategic thinking actually is rooted in the teaching of the Russian, of the Marshal of the Soviet Union, Nikolai Ogarkov, in what he referred to as the military technical revolution. A brief restatement of his thesis is that computers with accuracy and miniaturization were about to transform the modern battlefield, and that Americans are ahead in this respect, and we really have to do something about it because we are falling behind. So another also events affected the formation of the Russian information warfare doctrine and its subset of cyber warfare. They declared the first and second Gulf War as a war on technical, military technical revolution. But then fast forward, there was the Yeltsin's year, and in this year's theories actually developed theories rather than building machines, writing softwares, and running operations. And fast forward, there were a couple of other events, but a couple of years ago, Chief of the General Staff, Valery Gerasimov, published article in one of the military newspapers that actually was dubbed as a military, as the Gerasimov doctrine in the Western press. But actually he's saying that in a matter of months, a perfectly thriving state can be turned into a web of chaos. So they see information warfare and its subset of cyber warfare to achieve their objective in a various direction, whether it's a political direction or in the military direction or in any other fields. So let me just give you a couple of kind of a example how which are major players in this respect, which organizations are having major having upper hands actually in information warfare and in subset of cyber warfare. I'm going to give you a small historical overview about this. After in 2003, since Putin came to power in a couple of years, he actually disbanded the FAPSI, Federal Agency for Government Communication and Information. This agency was in charge of the military intelligence code cracking, cryptographic security, technical intelligence, counterintelligence. And once it was disbanded, so some of its functions went to those organizations, Federal Protective Service, FSO, Federal Security Service, FSB, MVDK, there is Ministry of Internal Affairs of Russia, SVR Foreign Intelligence, and GRU, Russian Military Intelligence. What is also very important here is large portion of the FAPSI that was left after the organization was renamed the Special Communication and Information Service and was folded into the FSB. So all of those organizations have their part in information warfare doctrine. What is also very important here, that's the leading role in this respect has the Russian military GRU and the Russian Federal Security Service FSB. So here is a kind of a, you know, structure, GRU's research, GRU's research institutes and units are participating in an information warfare, cyber warfare effort. So let me just give you kind of an overview about those MOD, Central Research Institutes and units. So Defense Ministry's 45th Center, Central Research Institute, is a military unit 54726. Those units actually are in charge of the finding intelligence about the military potentials of the foreign countries. Another unit here is centuries, the MOD centers, Ministry of Defense Center for Special Studies. Those center, they are hiring students from engineering schools. They are in charge of the analyzing, exploiting, finding vulnerabilities in a computer system. By the way, what is also very important is Evgeny Serebryakov, who was actually was expelled from Netherlands in 2018. Because he was trying to hack into the OPCW. OPCW is Organization for Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. It's a UN chemical watchdog organization. We were about to craft a report about the poisoning substance that was used against double agent Sergei Skripal and her daughter Yulia, as well as we were about to craft a report on the substance, chemical substance that was used in Duomo, Syria. So we actually wanted to find out what this report was about before its release. Another also major player is MOD's division, 12th B division, that is in charge of the cyber operation and psychological operation. Let me just talk a little bit about the 18th Central Research Institute and its unit 11135. Those folks are in charge of the signals intelligence. They are also in charge of development of wireless devices, SCADA system, or electromagnetic protection system. And what is also very important, that's 85 Central Research Institute, its unit 26165, main center for special technology, and its unit 7445. Those two units are the major, biggest repository of hacker talents. And those units together, all of them together, actually form the APT-28. This is the Advanced Persistent Threat Group. There is also known as the Fancy Bear, and has also other names. And they are using, of course, the hacker reserve forces for their hacking activities. I'm going to talk a little bit later about the Gunid and the Technopolis era, what kind of laboratories they have, including the biotech labs, and what kind of projects actually they are implementing. So another also kind of the development that's happened in the Russian military is in 2017, they officially announced about the formation of the military scientific units, also called information warfare troops. And what is also important, that's the Minister of Shoigu, Minister of Defense of Russia, officially made a statement about the formation of these units. And he made openly said that those units not only will be in charge of the securing, command and control and communication of the Russian military, or building, developing software for the National Defense Control Center. There is the high supreme body that's responsible for the defense ministry's supervision and management. But those guys also will be in charge of the psychological operation. That once again illustrates how actually Russia sees its information warfare doctrine, the concept of the security, a concept of the compartmentalization, and the idea of the cyber as a separate domain, I mean, doesn't exist in the Russian concept. What is also very important, that's so new warriors of these military scientific units, about the 1,000 personnel are incorporated those units. So they are the engineers, they are cryptographers, they are signalers, they are linguists, they are doctors, they are scientists. So let me just move a little bit talk about the Technopolis era. Technopolis era was opened in 2018, and according to the official sources, they want to make it fully operational by the end of 2020. ERA stands as the elite of Russian armies, they are planning actually to move these military scientific units, the 12th of those units that was created in 2018, on the permanent basis at Technopolis ERA. It is also believed that those military scientific units are the arms of the GRU, Russian military intelligence. So 8 major directions that they are working: information telecommunication, supercomputers, information and the cybersecurity, technical visions, energy technology, nanotechnologies, nanomaterials. But what is also very important, they're putting a lot of efforts, financial resources and human resources into the field of bioengineering, biosynthetic, biosensor technologies. What is also one of the major mission of the Technopolis era is actually find information about other countries, what other countries are doing in this respect, in this aid field, in this direction. Let me just talk a little bit about the who is coordinating the Technopolis era. I mean, officially it is coordinated by GUNID. This is the General Directorate for Research and Development and Technological Support of Advanced Technologies. They are cooperating with defense-related enterprises and over 200 scientific organizations, universities, Russian Academy of Science, have agreement with the Technopolis era. Some of those, and many, actually not some, quite, a, you know, over 40, 45 scientific organizations and defense-related enterprises, they have a permanent representation at the Technopolis era. Let me just talk about a little bit about the labs. They have 18 labs there, and they're working I'm going to talk about the projects in terms of the field of biotech. They are working in a 3D bioprinting, lab growing living tissues and bone tissues. They are working on the machine learning technologies in the healthcare for the diagnosing and treatment of illness, telesurgeries, working on the medical robotics and multimedia image communication, in silico clinical trials, and drug testing is one of their major direction, using computer models and simulation to develop and assess drugs and devices. What is also very important that they are putting a lot of efforts on a portable biological reconnaissance device. This is they're working a lot of efforts about a biosensor device designed to detect pathogens of dangerous infections, diseases, and viruses. And one of the major direction of the Technopolis era is the biological intelligence. They are developing devices, biosensor devices, they are also putting a lot of efforts about biological intelligence. Actually, they are concerned about the research activities conducted by foreign research institutions because they kind of feel that needs on appropriate reconnaissance in this respect, according to the statement of various government officials in Russia. The kind of the hallmark stealing the intellectual properties from that was the signature of the Chinese APD groups now we'll see this will be incorporated by the Russian APD groups, and we see already some signs actually in this respect. So a kind of interesting information, it's kind of a breaking news just recently, a few days ago, the Russian Ministry of Defense actually made a statement where it's also, very important to underline here is that together with the Gamaleya Scientific Research Institute of Epidemiology and Microbiology, they said that they successfully completed the trial of the COVID-19 vaccine. And by the way, the first minister of the deputy minister of the defense made a statement about this, that vaccine is actually ready and ready for distribution. Interesting information. Let me just talk a little bit about the FSB's role in this respect in the field of the information warfare and its subset of the cyber warfare. There are a lot of scientific and technical centers here and units, but I'm going to talk about two major units that are in charge of the cyber operation. So one is the unit of 7-1-1-3-3-0 and 7-6-4-8-2-9. They are under second directorate and 16th directorate. So those two centers are in charge, these units are in charge of the cyber, they have a very high cyber intelligence capabilities, and they're in charge of offensive information operation outside of Russia. So and inside of Russia. So unit 18th information center, also in charge of the Swarm system. Let me just give you kind of a overview about the Swarm system. Swarm is a system of operative investigative measures, the kind of a surveillance system that's now all the ISPs are required legally to install the system. This is a very sophisticated system that captures all the digital and mobile communication. It captures online communication, full recording of conversation, as well as the content of email, text, and the communication. So for online communication, for example, it taps to the network of the internet service providers through a rerouting devices called black boxes and high-speed communication lines. And by the way, it has a real-time monitoring capabilities. Here is a couple of example of what kind of the project they are implementing, on which I'm going to talk on my next slides. They are also actually in charge of the hacker reserve forces. Imagine having reserve forces that you don't pay anything, you don't train. They train themselves, they pay themselves, and they do business for the intelligence services in Russia. And of course, they form APD 29 group, also hacking group. Sponsored group. Has also different names, Kozytuk and Miniduk, etc., etc. Let me just talk about this project that's that's the siloviki, the people of power, Russian intelligence services are in charge. For example, this contracting organizations that were outsourced by the security services in Russia were hacked a couple of years ago and last year as well, and all of those projects actually they revealed on the net. One is a Nautilus project that was about to collect information on social media about users. Another is Nautilus S, that was about the de-anonymizing Tor traffic using rogue Tor servers. By the way, a couple of years ago, I mean, 1 or 2 years ago, 25 of those kind of rogue servers was identified, and 18 of which actually were located in Russia. They are also using the so-called scientific institute think tanks for their project. One of the think tank, pretty well-known think tank in Russia, is called Quantis, FSB think tank, and they are also were in charge of the developing software to detect protest mode among the population. Just a year ago, there was another leak hackers exposed, that's FSB IoT botnet project called Frontan, and so leaked document actually showed that the procurement order actually was placed by the FSB unit 64829. And let me just give you kind of a quick overview about the growing complexity of outsourcing and why the Russia use very sophisticated outsourcing strategy, because it's confound attribution, and it's also very cost effective for them. And so let me just see, but give you the whole scenario how it works. The idea actually comes from the government, and the government actually is in charge from the beginning of the whole command and control process. Then the project manager is assigned, and project management does the compartmentalization process. So tasks are broken into pieces, and so then people in the middle, they are also outsourcing hackers from other countries and subcontracting those hackers from Ukraine, from United States, from China, and from other countries. So people here, third parties, they actually don't know from where the original order actually comes. Then my money changes hands, and this is how the whole operation does. So if you want to just find out who is behind this or that project, it's very, very hard to just solve the attribution problem actually in this respect. So what we saw during this pandemic time, the Kremlin information warfare was used with full its capacity. They used the cyber elements, they used their disinformation elements, they used all the components of the information warfare. They spread the malicious content, malicious information. They used conventional media outlets. They used their scientists. They used trolls. They used the channels, non-conventional channels, for example, to spread this information. Not only in English and in Russian, but in various languages. And by the way, when I just did research about this, the views and shares of those information, it was into hundreds of thousands and into millions. But it's nothing new. So this kind of spreading false narratives, I mean, it's all tactics that Russian military and not only Russian military, FSB in general intelligence organizations were using in the past. For example, in the 1950s, the Soviet military intelligence created this woke fake reports that the U.S. used biological weapons in Korea, supposedly literally dropping bombs filled with insects and rats infected with cholera and plague. As well as, for example, in the late 1980s, Soviet spies spread false narratives that AIDS epidemic started from an experiment at a secret military biological lab in the US. They're also spreading false narratives about scientific institutions and labs in other countries. Supposedly, they are creating biological weapons or something like this. So, in March and April, there was a couple of reports published in this respect, how Russians were using APT groups, cyber criminal syndicates to hack into the research facilities, hospitals, and what kind of strategies, methodologies, and TTPs were they using. Now, just recently was published UK's National Cybersecurity Advisory that they openly said that APT-29 group that is associated with the FSB, Russian Federal Security Service, that this APTs actually are attempting to, APT-29 is attempting to steal information on coronavirus research targeting pharmaceutical companies, healthcare, academic research centers. So all aspects actually of information warfare elements was used. As I mentioned, that they use the conventional media, anonymous outlets, the cyber components. They tried to, created a fake coronavirus tracking webs, fake coronavirus application, ransomware targeting the healthcare system, on which I'm going to talk in detail in my next slides, targeting the VPN system, remote working tools and softwares. So here is actually a couple of examples what kind of fake bogus emails they are crafting, mimicking that's the legit organizations such as the World Health Organization, CDC, and other government agencies, and the government agencies as well. For example, cyber criminals in UK also use the SMS phishing strategy. Here is a screen they're sending to the UK resident that UK government has issued the payment of the of over £400 to old resident, and you have to just click to this link. And once you click to this link, it's actually asked you the national registration number as well as other information, banking information. The fake Android application also was created, was removed from the Google Play. So what actually, I'm going to talk about the fake life map that resembled Johns Hopkins University tracking coronavirus infographic map. I'm going to talk about this in more detail in my next slides. So what we also saw during this period, that's over the 1.2 million newly registered domains were created, and over 85,000 domains were classified as risky or malicious. Okay, here is the one of the criminal group called Sadin Akibi, as well as Ravel. This group has have a very heavy present on XSS forum. This group launches actually competition developing exploits for 0 days, writing crypto algorithms and other kind of a task that they post on this website, and they pay money. For example, the one of the competition was about $15,000. What is also very important, that they are also somewhere in February, we are already discussing the methods to deliver malware via an email attachment, then later was embedded into the COVID-19 Johns Hopkins infographic map. They also were selling the variants of malwares that later was embedded into the fake map. And for example, if you just opened it, it downloaded malicious code into your system. It collected information from the infected computer and sent this information to the command and control server. By the way, this group is a human-operated ransomware group. What actually does it mean? That's the attack doesn't happen in an automated fashion, but instead they are compromising internet-facing devices in order to establish presence in a vulnerable system and later then execute attack, steal information, and encrypt information on the victim's data. They were exploiting vulnerabilities in remote desktop protocols, vulnerabilities in the operating sound patch operating system, misconfigured servers, as well as the electronic health record software. What is also important, that's for their operation, they use the Mimikatz. Mimikatz is a leading exploitation tools that actually dumps the passwords from memory. This organization, this criminal organization actually also attacked the one of the biotech company that is based in California. And what is also very important here, that's they're not only interesting in stealing the intellectual properties from the biotech companies in the United States or in European countries, but also they were trying to gain some financial, launching cyber attacks for this financial game, pure financial games. For example, they attacked the New York law firm, this is the one of the prominent, very well-known law firm that has a very high level clientele and asked for a ransom. So I already said that Russian deep web forum, dark web forum, hacker forum were very busy during this time period. A lot of discussions were going on those forums, even selling the variants of malwares, discussing the methodologies about how to embed malicious code into the email and some other, and the COVID-19 issue was very highly discussed, and all of these TTPs and methodologies on those forums. As I mentioned, that's already in one of those forums, we were offering malware for sale that later was inserted into email attachment resembling the fake COVID-19 map. So those dark web forum are also there are a lot of other dark hacker forums actually that's are on the root domains and the pseudomains. If you don't know what is a pseudomain, it's all Soviet Union domain. It's actually has over 120,000 registered domains there. So a lot of interesting information. Could have been you could some one can gather from those forums, and it gives you kind of a good understanding what they're up to, what they are planning, what kind of strategies they are discussing for future attacks. So another also group that was very active during this period was a haters group. This group is associated with the Russian military, military GRU with APT-28 group, also called the Fancy Bear Sandwar, Voodoo Bear, Telebots, and it has also some other names as well. They were using the phishing email campaign mimicking World Health Organization and the Ministry of Health of Ukraine. They were sending, here's the example what kind of emails they were sending to the organizations in Ukraine. And not only in Ukraine, where most of this group was active in European countries, in particular, heavily active in Ukraine. And once you, open this file, it's downloaded malicious macro code to perform the remote control. Another also group that was very active during this time was a Gamma Radon. This is the FSB group. They also targeted the organization. They targeted scientific research centers, hospitals all over the Western countries. This group is associated with FSB 16th and 18th centers as the undersecond and 16th directorate of FSB, active since 2013, attacking Ukraine since 2014. So once you actually opened the document, it started a template injection technique. So for loading the document templates from the internet, and once the document was downloaded, it executed that malicious macro code which executed VBS scripts. So here is actually IP addresses are from the Russian hosting companies. Those IP addresses that this group is used for network destination for template injection and network destination for VBS script. So another also organization that was a cyber criminal group that was very active during this time, but that was group Russian ransomware group called MACE. This group used a variety of techniques by exploiting known vulnerabilities that was not haven't been patched, remote desktop connection with a weak password. They used malicious emails with links. They attacked not only the research institutes, scientific centers, but as well as they also attacked, for example, IT service providers company that provides this kind of services for the healthcare industries and manufacturing. In March, they attacked the Hammersmith Medicines Research Center in UK. So this center was before involved with an Ebola solution and working with the COVID-19 vaccine. So what is also very important about this ransomware group, that's this group is not kind of typical data encrypting ransomware. So it's not doesn't infect and encrypt computers in every computer that is in its path, but also it is destructing information and data to the attacker servers. Let me just talk a little bit about the Biohacking. This is another Russian hacking group. This hacking group also attacked hospitals and in Europe and the United States. For example, they attacked the second largest hospital in Czech Republic in Brno. Before the pandemic, they actually attacked the hospitals in Alabama, and they asked for the big ransom to decrypt them and unlock medical data. This ransomware is typically the attack, they actually already get into the compromise system. For example, they used in this respect the Emotel and TrickBot. The Emotel is a malware that originally actually was created for the banking Trojan designed to steal information. And once the system was infected, then their Ryuk payload was dropped into the system and executed, and it's actually a encryption process actually started, and they were asking the ransom to decrypt the data back. So for attack vectors, they are trying to find vulnerabilities into the system, remote desktop protocol, and poorly secure RDP ports. They use the phishing email, sending a malicious bogus email to trick legit organizations to download this emails, open and download documents on from this organization, tricking actually legitimate organizations. So, and this is actually what I wanted to talk, how actually Russians use the their information warfare strategy, its elements of cyber warfare during this pandemic time. Of course, I just would like to talk to you a little bit about the mitigation strategy, and we also talk a lot of countermeasures. Our community, how actually what kind of steps should be taken in order to secure system, to diminish risk, to decrease risk in this respect. Of course, important factor is that to assess the supply chain. That's a supply chain contamination is a big problem in this respect. Unpatched system was exploited by those hackers. Of course, it's very important having them to implement a multi-factor authentication methods, as well as train the staff in this respect. But what is also very important here, and in most cases, nobody talks about putting the threat intelligence into the mitigation strategy. For example, before the pandemic, all of those Russian forums were discussed, all of those methodologies and selling the malwares on those forums. I think that's observing what's going on a dark web, deep web, Russian hacking forums. It must be included in a mitigation strategy because it gives you a pretty good understanding what we are up to and what we are planning in the future. So thank you very much. I hope you'll find this presentation very interesting, and I'm looking forward to a Q&A section. Thank you.